What if? Great science fiction lives and dies by its conceits. Those heady what-ifs that underpin the best fantastical films or pulpy paperbacks. What if we could infiltrate people's dreams? What if criminals sent their marks back in time to be disposed of? What if this was all just a simulation? The genre is referred to as the literature of ideas, and the best of these ideas take root swiftly. They catch in the mind and blossom organically, with all the rippled repercussions the creator need not implicitly explore. The genre is a breeding ground, then, for spectacular short stories, tales keen to present their unique hook and leave us wanting more. Whether in the depths of space or somewhere closer to home, no matter if we're making first contact or passing the fabric of time itself, sci-fi so often chooses to say a lot with very little. When it comes to such high-concept storytelling, director Yasuhiro Yoshiura has proven himself a master. His dogged pursuit of premise and the purity that can be found in such focus results in a library perhaps best described as fleeting. In his work in both television and film, Yoshiura's short pictures never outstay their welcome. Their own what-ifs. What if we escaped the death of the planet by disappearing beneath its crust? What if half our population had their gravitational polarities inverted? Are wonderfully underexplored. These delicious story threads, hiding in the margins of his work, are waiting to be pulled by an inquisitive mind. Your inquisitive mind. In doing so, in asking you to play a part in the weaving of such tales, we're beckoned deeper, and more meaningfully, into the fiction of these worlds. Their wonderful what-ifs, hanging Damoclean above perilous worlds, linger long after the credits have crawled. But there's a preoccupation in Yoshiura's library, a recurring theme that, over the years, the director has approached from multiple interesting angles. The rise of the android. In the deceptively advanced age of robotics we find ourselves in, where our houses are packed with artificial intelligence and the phrase machine learning seems more terrifyingly loaded than ever before.
Wow. I guess cell phones are bad for you.
Yoshiura wants us to consider our symbiosis with technology. Take a look at how ridiculously dependent on it we already are. Question how we may one day accept, reject, or indeed rage against the birth of the kind of robot science fiction has been promising us for decades. Time of Eve is Yoshiura's first real treatise on such a question. In this peculiar future, androids are already old news. They've long filled our menial roles and even raised our children. But as time has gone on, they have evolved, moving away from the clunky clichés of black and white B-movies to inhabit eerily indistinguishable human shells. This uncanny facade, and the omnipresence of such a technology, has started to wear on society, and anti-android sentiment bubbles quietly in the corners of the work. On propaganda-filled billboards, sensationalist news programs, and in the quietly cruel ways we treat our cold companions, the world is finally questioning what strange future we have wrought. It's this newfound tension that Time of Eve, an unassuming cafe hidden away in the back streets, seeks to quietly dismantle. Originally released in 6 short episodes and later compiled into a movie, either version of Time of Eve acts as an anthology of sorts, with each chapter posing a different question about life with robots. These questions are mulled over by the various patrons of the titular cafe, a colourful collection that are all too easy to fall for. But Time of Eve hides a secret. Upon entering, androids are illegally required to turn off their digital halos, the only thing that distinguishes them from their human counterparts. And in doing so, the final boundary between the two is torn away. Disallowed from discussing origin, our leads must put away what separates them and find instead common ground. To come together as one people, some man, some machine, but each of them with a voice and a story to tell. Watching these characters interact, none of whom knowing who or what they're talking to, is strangely thrilling stuff. More delightfully, however, is that the question, who is a robot, quickly becomes irrelevant, asking instead whether such a question even matters. At times, it's an ugly thing to watch. Science fiction often revels in the thin and fragile veneer of humanity, and it delights in pulling it away and reminding us that we aren't as evolved as we like to believe. But in Time of Eve, Yoshiura assures us that there's hope for us yet. In Rikuo, our protagonist and audience surrogate, we see a product of the propaganda regarding androids, but we also get to witness the healing effect the cafe has on him. An antidote to all that ugliness. Breaking down these barriers is not easy. Indeed, it would be a reductive piece of media if it was. There's a struggle here, even in the idyllic oasis of Time of Eve. And though everyone is told not to consider it, no one can help but obsess over the who's who of the cafe's eclectic clientele. The story, too, asks us to enjoy the guessing game, to join the android witch hunt, to try and figure out who's hiding a halo. It's an admittedly fun hook, made more enjoyable still by the devilish double bluffs and stacked revelations. But Yoshiura is ultimately still here to judge us, or at least have us judge ourselves, to question his character's prejudices and, in turn, our own. Time of Eve sticks around just long enough to prove its point beautifully, leaving you ruminating on it long after that final fade to black. So much of science fiction obsesses over the indeterminable gulf between humanity and our artificial counterparts. A divide full of questions about creation, about free will, about the soul. But few present a discourse as succinct and inviting as Time of Eve. It's funny, and it's sweet, and it's achingly poignant at times. But most importantly, its heady philosophy feels approachable, because of how it wills you to interact with its work directly, and in doing so, feel personally humbled by its quiet revelations. Despite the obvious semantic answer, Yoshiura posits the question of whether humanity is a quality exclusive to humans. It's a question that hangs in the quiet atmosphere of Time of Eve, a question that sticks with its viewers years after watching, and a question that Yoshiura himself returned to with his latest work. Sing a bit of harmony. Can the ineffable qualities of being human be programmed? Can a soul exist between lines of code? Can humanity be breathed into the inherently inhuman? In one of the most joyous animated movies I've watched in a very long time, Yoshiura answers plainly, yes. With its singing android, its goofy cast of kids, its laugh-out-loud slapstick humour and its popcorn plot, Sing a Bit of Harmony feels like a salve to the melancholia of Time of Eve. There's nothing remotely melancholic here. How could there be? In this all-singing, all-dancing movie, there's barely space for teen melodrama, let alone pondering ruminations on the soul. Satomi is your typical teenage lead. Willful, mature, and just a touch ostracized. Though she comes from a rural town, in this far-flung future, it's the Silicon Valley of Japan, where new technological marvels seem to roll out every day. The newest, spearheaded and developed by Satomi's mother, is an artificial intelligence named Shion. So advanced that it's being secretly transferred into Satomi's school to see if it can pass as a real kid. There's only one problem. There is a ghost in the machine, and it won't stop singing. For some reason, Shion believes her singular directive is to make Satomi happy.
Satomi, 今幸せ?
And she intends to do so by turning the movie into an anime rarity, a musical. Our heroes are initially taken aback when she starts trying to fix problems by singing loudly at them. They aren't part of a stage show, after all. They're a bunch of kids who can't think of anything more mortifying than, well, this. But in the face of such infectious optimism, it's impossible for them, and for us, not to fall head over heels for Shion. Whilst there's connective tissue between the two, Sing a Bit of Harmony and Time of Eve are ultimately separated by the purity of that optimism. There's a refreshing one-dimensionality here. Stripped of the intriguing philosophy of Time of Eve, the absolute lack of moral quandary is strangely liberating. Technology, robots and singing androids are the best, it posits, and our world is less colourful, less musical, less magical for the lack of them. I love the questions Time of Eve raises, but this, a song sung in the throes of a judo match, made me smile ear to ear. In these two pictures, Yoshiura offers a glimpse at a future with artificial companions, a future that feels less fantastical with every passing day. But between singing androids and secretive robots, his vision feels far from comprehensive. Indeed, it's a well I hope he revisits in the future, to wring even more juice from that particular fruit. Yoshiura's androids are uniquely human. They speak to us in ways only the best science fiction can, and even make us question our own humanity. In a world where technological evolution is inevitable, where our black and white notions on robotics are barreling towards an age awash with greys, we need to consider how we will respond the day true artificial intelligence says hello. I intend to sing. As always, thanks for watching. I've actually been working on a video about a different android for the last couple of months, but there's still a ways to go on that project. In the interim, I decided to take a break and make a short video about one of my favourite anime movies of the last few years. I hope it's a diversion you enjoyed, and I really hope the wait for the Chobits video will be worth it. Special thanks to my patrons, who stick with me even during these extended projects. I truly couldn't do any of this without you guys. If you want to join their ranks, you can pledge a buck over on the Patreon. Otherwise, please consider following me here on YouTube or over on Twitter to stay posted about future releases. If, instead, you think I should follow in Shion's mechanical footsteps and sing all of my future scripts, hit the like button and I'll enact that uniquely terrible vision of the future.